أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ये तो काफी मुश्किल होगा आखिर में, लेकिन एक जुमला मैंने सुना था कि रिविजन इज गुड, तो प्रॉबेबली आई विल ट्राई टू समराइज एंड टू रिवाइज व्हाट वी हैव लिसन एंड व्हाट वी वर टॉट. बट बिफोर दैट I must say few verses from the Holy Quran. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. In bismillahir rahmanir rahim kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Aur main kahunga ki kisi ke chale jane se koi mar nahi jata. Bahut saron ko main dekha ki the one who were lovers, the one who dies next day they are ignored and they forget, they forget probably. But हाँ, मगर जीने के अल्फाज बदल जाते हैं. प्रोफेसर इजाज अली शाह वॉज द पायनियर ऑफ न्यूरोसर्जरी इन KPK. He was a person who played a real role in my life as well. Because I always said that Dr. Tariq Saab, he picked me, and Professor Ijaz Ali Shah, he pulled me, and Professor Tariq Khan, he pushed me in neurosurgery. And these are the three people, they have played a real goal and a real role in my life. What I am today and what I was, it was because of these people. He was my mentor. And he showed utmost interest in educating his students and making neurosurgery easy to grasp. He worked tirelessly to empower us with the power of knowledge. क्योंकि उसने हमें मौका दिया बोलने का, उसने हमें मौका दिया काम करने का. And he was very friendly with us. Even in the ward round and in the office. And probably when if someone has traveled with him, so usko uska wo yaad hoga. He was a jolly person. Aur har mauke pe wo ek latifa zarur sunaya karte the. Aise topic nahi tha, right from the religion se leke aur social event tak aur politics par, ke wo na bol sake. He was a good clinician, and of course, he was a good administrator. And I must say, ये बिछड़ा कुछ सदा से कि रुत ही बदल गई. एक शख्स था जिसने इस पूरे पेशावर को नहीं कुरुए का KPK को वीरान कर दिया. With these words, I start my presentation, and probably that was endoscopy in the KPK. We all know that endoscopy is a procedure, and endoscope is a tool which is used in this modern era of neurosurgery, which means to visualize neuronal structure for the purpose of diagnosis and treatment. So if you use endoscope for the purpose of diagnosis, it becomes diagnostoscope, and when you use it for the purpose of treatment, it becomes a therapeutic scope. So we use endoscope for both purposes. It can be used in the brain, in the spine, as well as for the peripheral nerve in the neurosurgery. But the use of endoscope started, you see, first by the urologist, then by the gynecologist, then by the general surgeon, then the thoracic surgeon, the ENT colleague, the ophthalmologist. And if you consider it, the growth starts from below up. And ultimately, neurosurgeon used this in the brain. And the first endoscope which was used, that was probably it was a cystoscope in the brain. So the history is more than 100 years. We know that. And there are different types of the scopes, the rigid one and the flexible one. And one must differentiate difference between the endoscope and the microscope. And in short words, one can say that endoscope is basically bringing microscope in a surgical field. And when we are talking about neurosurgical procedure, so for any procedure, we need three things: good illumination, magnification, and proper exposure. For any neurosurgical procedure, I repeat again, we need illumination, magnification, and good exposure. And endoscope is a tool which provides these three facilities. It has different parts like light source, camera, and monitor. And the light source has two types, the xenon and the halogen one. A camera, it started from the first chip camera, which still I have, and now it is the HD camera, which of course I do have. So on both sides, I have the first chip camera and the HD camera. The concept of endoscopy, which I told, that is proper illumination and magnification. How we started this endoscopy in KPK? There was a step ladder learning curve. Initially, with the help of after microscopy, we used to use endoscope. So this was microscope followed by endoscope. Then we started endoscope followed by microscope. Then endoscope assisted surgery, and in the end, purely endoscopic surgery. How we started the procedure? So this is a startup format which I give to my students, that one should have first theoretical concept for any sort of workshop, for any sort of learning new procedure, theoretical concept, that is literature and textbook studies. Then the dry lab work, and then the cadaveric work. And in the end, the OR experience as an observer, under direct supervision, under indirect supervision, and then independently. So this is how we learn different procedure when we started. And this was the first announcement in the news from KPK when we started endoscopy. And I must remember this gentleman who traveled from Lahore just for ETV. And we selected 5 cases. And first we have workshop, that was literature, followed by hands-on, and then we went to theater. And the same day we operated 5 cases. That was the beginning of the cranial endoscopy, the ventricular endoscopy in the KPK. And this was followed by the person who has arranged this beautiful conference. And he traveled from Karachi to Peshawar. And we operated first case of transperineal endoscopic surgery, a pituitary, in afternoon time. And Professor Salman Sharif, he was the second person who started skull-based neurosurgery, endoscopic surgery, with us in KPK. So these two names, Professor Nadeem and Professor Salman, they were the beginner teachers in endoscopy for our students in KPK. With variable results, the result were, you see, they changes with passage of time, with experience, and when you are doing it more and more, then you open the different corridors. But I always remember these two names. And alhamdulillah, with the continuous work, we gain a status that we started and performing endoscopy, then we became the facilitator of endoscopy. And we did 2 workshops with the CMH colleagues in CMH Rawalpindi, and regular workshop in the KPK different teaching hospital. And every 2 yearly, we used to conduct one teaching workshop for the student. Most of, probably of the student may have visited Peshawar for these workshop. And then Professor Amjit Shad, again he participated in the last endoscopic workshop. So this is, the struggle was a tech study, hands-on and surgical workshop. These were the few pictures. So the procedure are for the cranial, that is intraventricular, and for the skull base. Intraventricular procedure, you can do ventricular leverage in case of intraventricular hemorrhage and in patient with ventriculitis. And then you can put VP shunt. Ventriculostomy, probably third ventriculostomy. Aqueductoplasty and putting stunt. Septum pericardiotomy with or without ETV, or septum pericardiotomy with or without VP shunt. Foramina manroplasty and endoscopic shunt replacement and shunt removal. Those cases in which the shunt ventricular catheter remained inside the ventricle, it was lying for years and years. We removed in 7 cases. And again, the endoscopic assisted microsurgery, like the microvascular decompression. These were the cranial cases. And in the skull base, of course, then the endoscopic assisted and endoscopic pituitary surgery, then the CCA pranuria. And nowadays, probably the fist procedure, biopsy from the malignant tumor in the paracavernous and in the skull base region, and cardioma we operated. And we operated 3 cases of craniopharyngioma transsphenoidally. We have not used it in, personally, I have not used it in spine, but my colleague, Dr. Shahid, he is using endoscope in his hospital. So that was the beginning, and the growth start like this. In peripheral nerves, I don't think anyone is using in Pakistan, but when I visit Germany 2-3 times, they are using it routinely for the carpal tunnel and for the cubital tunnel syndromes. These are the different parts. And now we have started operating on intraventricular tumor as well, with the help of the endoscope. And we succeeded in operating 6 cases of pineal tumor, combining it with the ETV and tumor resection. So it is a good teaching tool. You can use it in multi-loculated hydrocephalus to communicate all the ventricle with each other, because this is a big real dilemma and difficult topic for us. Everyone is putting shunt, and that loculated area is drained, and the rest of the ventricle, the compartment remain as such. So when we combine these loculated ventricular system into one room, we can put VP shunt. The ventricular cystocysternostomy, and again, this was the main reason, in patient with repeated shunt blockage, that there was arachnoid cyst in the third ventricle. And every time we were revising the shunt, but with the help of endoscope, we diagnosed that this is an arachnoid cyst. And now we are doing arachnoid cystectomy, aspiration, and then ETV with endoscope. For microvascular decompression, we have not often used it, only in 4 or 5 cases for assisted and for demonstrating to the students. The advantages, I told you, with a single burr hole, you can see the whole ventricular system. And we started teaching ventricular anatomy to the anatomist of the medical college as well, because they think and they thought about the ventricle, and we showed them that how to see the whole ventricular system with the help of one burr hole. So you can see the both lateral ventricle, the third ventricle, the aqueduct, even the fourth ventricle in the different foramina. And we started this coagulation of the choroid plexus in patient who were resistant and in children who were having macrocephaly large enough that they were not responding to ETV only. So we combined ETV with the choroid plexus coagulation in this patient. This is another use of endoscope. Too much was talked about the ETV, but I always give a format to the students that for any surgical procedure, please remember 5 P's. The first P is for preoperative documentation, evaluation. The second P is for position of the patient and anesthesia. The third P is for the portal. And the fourth P is for the procedure, while the fifth P is for the postoperative care. And this makes the surgical step very easy to remember for the students who are appearing in exam. So once we make, initially we used to give incision in a linear way at a Kakar point. Then we started giving incision in transverse way. And then we thought that if you are making flap, so probably the chance of CCF leak will decrease. And if the ATV fail, then you can use the same stroma for putting the VP shunt. So that is why now we make a flap and we for making the burr hole, because this stroma can be used for the frontal shunt. Once the endoscope is introduced, so now there are 2 things. One is the road on which you start traveling, and that is the choroid plexus, which start from the temporal horn. So you ride on the road, and when you reach to the foramen of Monro, then this is a compass for you. And you see the north and the west, the north and the south, and the east and the west. When you enter in third ventricle, you see the mammary bodies. And in front of the fourth, the mammary bodies, the area of tuber cinereum. Again, this was a difficult for us where to make the stroma. And for the students, because if you are appearing in exam and giving an academic answer, so that was to measure the distance between the tube, the infundibular recess, and in front of the 2 mammary bodies, and divide this into 3. And the interior 1/3 and middle 1/3, that is the ideal space for making the stroma. Then how to create the stroma, either with the probe or with the cautery, or some people, they are making the stroma even with the endoscope. So again, there is difference. But the easy thing is that you put the probe on the dorsum spinodal and just push it. You will be always in the prepontine cistern. But remember that before ETV, one must have a clinical concept, either this patient is fit enough for ETV or not. And for that, we consider the age, the pattern of the disease, and the previous surgery. Then we must read the radiology. And in radiology, the third ventricle and the both lateral ventricle, they must be dilated. If the lateral ventricle is, you see, if it is not dilated, then endoscopy is probably contraindicated. Because the diameter of the scope, it is more than 6.5 millimeter. So the ventricle must be larger than that to put the scope. The third ventricle must be dilated, must be more than 5 millimeter. Because you are introducing a scope in the third ventricle. So if the third ventricle is squashed, is small, performing this ETV will become relatively difficult. We must concentrate on these 5 veins, the septal vein, the choroidal vein, again, the caudal vein, you see, and the thermostat vane. And where these veins are uniting, now it sometime you cross the septum pellucidum, it becomes difficult, either you are on the right side or on the left side. So the easy way is, if the thalamostat vein is on the right side, you are in the right ventricle. And if the thalamostat is on the left side, you are in the left ventricle. That is what I have learned in the first 10, 12 years during performing this procedure. When the stoma is made, always inspect the prepontine cistern for the vessel and for the membrane of Lilliquest. If you don't see the vessel, and if you don't see the membrane of Lilliquest and that is not punctured, the result will be not satisfactory. So before putting the scope, radiologically one must see the prepontine cistern. If it is not visible, it becomes a contraindication for ATV. And once you introduce your scope, you must see the prepontine cistern with the scope. Either the vessel are probably visible and the membrane of Lilliquest has been fenestrated or not. Then when you are concentrating on the floor of the third ventricle, the floor, if it is everted, it is a good case. If it is inverted or flat, so probably the result will be poor. Because everted floor indicate that the prepontine cistern is open. And then one must see the flow of CSF and the movement in the flap which you have made with the endoscope. These were few points regarding the endoscopy for the aqueduct stenosis or for the triventricular hydrocephalus. So in my practice, I always do endoscopy as a first choice for monoventricular hydrocephalus, for biventricular hydrocephalus, and for the triventricular hydrocephalus. In case of panventricular hydrocephalus, I explain to the patient that I will do the procedure successfully, but the result may or may not be that much good. So if the result are not shown postoperatively, probably we may go for the VP shunt. So in adult, now we are switching from VP shunt for the VA shunt, and in the children, VP shunt. Well, when we are doing the cranial based endoscopy, we started this cranial based and this transpineal surgery with our ENT colleague first. So the learning curve was, initially we started doing the SMR, then the paraseptal approach, then the endoscopic, microscopic approach, and then in the end, purely endoscopic. This was the arachnoid cyst in the temporal horn. And there, you see the third ventricle is the main landmark for you. The third nerve. If you see the third nerve, in case of temporal arachnoid cyst, you just follow that and you create a stoma at that window. So you will be probably in the cistern, the prepontine cistern. These are the few pictures of pituitary adenoma and for the hydrocephalus. Then when we were coming, this video was made by the medical students of the final year. This how we So we dissect the pericranium separately and we make a flap. Initially we used to put the self-retaining. Now we just apply a stretch. So once you apply a stretch to the flap, you are free, you see. And then the pericranial flap is made. When the dura, we always accumulate and preserve the bone dust. And when C-SEP start coming, please never, never introduce the scope if you have not seen this, the C-SEP. Otherwise, you will be always in trouble. So make sure that C-SEP start coming. And when you introduced, then follow the same, the road and the compass. You must see the basilar artery in the prepontine cistern. And then close. And this was the video which we shared with you. So, in the end, I must say that it is impressive that the young neurosurgeon and the resident, they become familiar and comfortable with the endoscopic technique, and hopefully they will progress further when they start using this scope as a beginner. With these words, I must congratulate to Professor Salman and his team, and I am thankful to all my colleagues and my seniors as well as my juniors, because I always repeat that the student of today become the colleague of tomorrow, and they remain friends forever. And probably I am one of those who was student yesterday, next day he became a colleague, and I always claim that I am friend of neurosurgeon forever. Thank you very much. If there is any question,